Again, thank you very much, everyone, for being here. Let me see if I can get the microphone to actually... Is that... Can you hear me in the back there? Yes? Okay, good. But I'm just a loud mouth, so... So what we're going to go ahead and do is the way the panel will go up here with the candidates and our incumbent, we'll be going from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 with the question. So and then we'll go ahead and start again, just to kind of keep that rhythm. In the end, as Terry mentioned, we'll have an opportunity to direct a question to one of the candidates or the incumbent. That's just because of time constraints. All right, so starting from the beginning, we have Nathan Carrizales. Then we have Jessica Guerrero. Jessica O. Guerrero, thank you very much. Rebecca J. Viagran. I learned quick. Okay. Sylvia E. Don. Thank you. So Sylvia E. Don. Ismael Reyes. So let's go ahead and get started without further ado. And question number one, and you each have a minute. If you start going over your minute, there will be a timekeeper in the back. 3 minutes, I'm so sorry. You have 3 minutes for your opening, for your opening, and you can begin now.
Testing, there we go. Oh, that's good. All right, hi everybody. Thank you for coming out this morning. I am Nathan Carrizales, candidate for City Council District 3. And my message is simple. I want to refresh, refine, repair District 3. And we need to honor and respect the residents that are living here. And I feel like we need to push on public safety especially. And one of my main goals is to establish a connection between myself and the residents. A lot of residents have felt like they've been left out. And I want to be a voice for those who have felt like they're being left out of the system. My main focus, there's three topics that I want to cover that I really want to hit. It's public safety, infrastructure, and small business. Now here in this side of the district where the mission is at, there's so much potential for growth for small business. I envision businesses where they reflect the culture that's down here. And you know, there's generations of people. My grandparents have lived here for over 50 years. And that's the type of community that there is. And we need to respect that. And so I want to be a voice for those, the seniors especially. And we need to look out for our seniors. We need to look out for each other. And so I'm running for city council to represent the people. And that's what it's all about. Thank you very much.
Buenas tardes. Buenos días todavía, right? My name is Jessica Guerrero. Thank you so much for being here. I'm running for District 3 City Council. I'm born and raised in San Antonio and very proud to be born and raised in the Southeast Side. I grew up in the Maquiles area and I still live there. My parents still live there in the same area. And I'm very proud to be from the Southeast Side of San Antonio, and I want to be sure that so many of my neighbors that are just as proud as I am, that have made the decision either to stay and continue living here or have gone to other places and have returned, I want to make sure that they have that option to return to the Southeast Side, and you know, come back to the same place that they left, right? To the same heart, to the same soul of this city that they love this area for. In my time as a grassroots organizer, as a community service worker, you know, I've been on this side of the dais and working in community to make sure that our voices are heard, and been really frustrated along with many people that we feel our voices are not heard, our perspectives are not only not considered, but not respected. And that has created, I think, a huge gap between our Southside communities and what is going on at City Hall. The decisions that are made at City Hall directly impact us, and we should be the first most prioritized stakeholders in any decisions that take place at City Hall, and right now that's not the case. I want to be a city council person para todos, for all of District 3. I want District 3 to lead in creating fair housing policy that we very much lack and very much need in this city. I do not want to see what happened at Mission Trails ever happen again in District 3 or anywhere else in San Antonio. And the way we're growing, the way we're, you know, we can expect some growing pains, but not that type. We should not see any displacement happen throughout the city for the sake of luxury apartments or developer benefits. I want to be sure that District 3 residents are calling the shots in District 3, not developers.
Okay, great,
thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Rebecca Viagran, and I am honored to serve as City Councilwoman for District 3, the South and the Southeast side of San Antonio. As a proud daughter of the South Side, born and raised here with roots that go back for over 250 years, it's important to me that we continue to maintain the balanced approach here. I believe District 3 has made great strides here, and all we need to do is look around us right here in this area. I think this is an example of working together. If you would like to, one thing that I am very proud of is working with the neighborhood associations and with the neighborhoods in the area and the neighbors in the area. Because of your voice and because of your activity and action, we were able to make sure that we have what we see building right here. A YMCA, the first YMCA here in this area, in this part of town. One that I know the neighbors have worked years and years on, but were stalled. It was stalled at the city staff level. Coming into office, working with the neighborhoods, taking up the cause and saying, we will not be put on pause anymore. We are District 3 and we are worth it and we deserve something like this and so much more. And because of that, we moved forward and now we have this here being built, but it's not stopping there. Because of your perseverance and working together, we have in the bond another $2 million to put into this YMCA to complete phase 2 and 3 with the pool that you all wanted, that the neighborhoods wanted to continue the healthy lifestyle of our community. So working together with the neighbors and the neighborhood associations is something that I have done, that I'm going to continue to do, and that I want to make sure that we walk hand in hand. Because when I was put into the position, the status quo, I'm not settling for the status quo anymore. We have made these large strides forward. We have been underinvested and overlooked, and now we are seeing the investment coming into our community. And I want to make sure that we can maintain that momentum with your partnership, with your work, and I will continue to be your voice. And it comes with a balanced approach for our community. Many of you all were part of the World Heritage Work Plan. This could not have moved forward without your insight and input. What grew out of that organic approach was authentic development in our community. And we are working on that together. And we are continuing to make strides and change to better enhance that communication between City Hall and with the neighbors and the neighborhoods. We're continuing to work on that with letting you know access to the neighborhood, to what permits are being built and why they're being built. And I will continue to maintain my open door policy in having these conversations with you. So my name is Rebecca Viagran and I ask for your vote. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
If I could ask, just for the time up, I believe the minute went up, but it wasn't the time up. So I wasn't, yes. Yeah, so when that time is up, if you could just give me the time up instead of the minute, that way we make sure. Yes, it was confusing me a little bit.
And it,
yes, you showed me the minute up, and I apologize, because we want to be fair to all of the candidates to make sure that they don't feel they're getting too little time. Or that other candidates don't feel other candidates are getting too much time. So if you could just, when they've reached their 3 minutes, correct? It's the three-minute mark?
3 minutes, yeah.
Show me the time up. Okay. Thank you, Armando. Appreciate it very much. So our next candidate.
Good morning, everybody. And I want to thank you so much for coming today and for also for being invited here today. I feel that I'm running for city council because I feel that there are so many things that people, when in office or running for office, say that they will tell you that, oh, I'll do this and I'll do that, and they promise you the world, but when it really gets down to the real thing that you're in office, you forget about the people. We gotta remember one thing, that you, the people, the community, are the ones that have the right to say yay or nay, not us. Me, I'm not here for the money. I'm not here for anything like that. I'm here because also I am a resident. I grew up in the South Side, military in 35. My parents bought a house. I was educated. Then as time went by, I got married. I've lived in my house for 31 years, and I've never had anybody come to my street and do anything for 31 years. I hear you. I hear you. And I know that if you elect me, I will make sure that what I say is going to be what is going to be done for the community. The taxpayers' dollars is for everybody, and it should be given equally, not to certain entities, as it has been. The bonds go to every bond election to the same ones over and over. And it's time to put a stop to that and spread the good, the wealth. Everybody deserves a good street, sidewalks, drainage, lights. And I ask for you to think twice about who you're going to vote. Sylvia Don no se vende a ningún lobbyist nor investor. Sylvia Don is not for sale to no investor, no lobbyist. I am here for the people, for the community. I am so sad that what happened to the people at the Mission Trail Mobile Home Park, and that's one of the reasons why I chose to run. That won't happen. I've lived most of my life in the South Side. My parents bought a house there, and I am here. I ask for your vote on May 6th. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for being here for us five candidates. They're running for City Council District 3. I'm Ismael Reyes, and I grew up in the southwest part of San Antonio. I've been a San Antonio all my life. I grew up as a Centenos. I grew up as a Saldanias in the southwest side of San Antonio, south side of San Antonio. I grew up as Bud Jones. I did the malt chops and all that good stuff. So just tell you a little bit about myself. I have three children, beautiful wife, been married to her 45 years. And that's right, to the same lady for 45 years. When I was in my 30s and 40s, I raised a family. I gave them a good education. I worked all through my young adult life, raising a good family. Now, I have two boys and a girl, and they're very successful with their education that we gave them, or us, all of us gave them, because of the public schools that were involved with it. So, but let me tell you what I stand for, okay? Gentrification, also displacement of the third of the old generation around the missions, very, very fearful that they will lose their home to prospective developers around the missions. Also, number two, I'm looking for jobs, not cashier jobs, not janitor jobs, and not clerk jobs like at the Walmarts and the stripes that we get in the South Side. I'm looking for good jobs, career jobs for our youth, and even for our mid-age crisis people that are 40 and 50 years old. We need jobs like that in our district. Give you an example, we lost two things, maybe three things in the recent past. We lost Microsoft. They were paying $75,000 a year. We lost it to a different district. And recently, we lost 500 new jobs to Hulu, to District 8. And why can't we bring them to District 3? where we have so much land that is a lot less expensive than in District 8. That's what we need. We need a good police force in San Antonio to fight against crime. Yes, we believe in our neighborhood associations that we communicate and we go and we tell people that somebody's around the neighborhood, but we're not cops. We can't stop the people breaking into our houses. We can only call them. When you call a policeman and it's at 12 midnight around your neighborhood, how long does it take them to get there to stop the party or to stop the drug deals? Maybe an hour, maybe 45 minutes. So that's a long time. All of us have had that opportunity to do something about it. So we vote for me, number six in District 1. Thank you. District 3, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. So you have the opening statements there from the candidates and the incumbent. So we're going to go ahead and start with five questions now. We're going to start again from the beginning. You will have exactly 1 minute. And now when you see that time up, come up over there. And if you start, you know, going over, I'll tell you, hey, it's time to go ahead and wrap it up. Okay? Sounds good. I won't be just like, hey, wrap it up. So I'll be very polite. So let's go ahead and start with Mr. Carrizales with question number one. How committed are you to protecting environmental policies, for example, the aquifer, tree ordinances, river overlay, and green spaces? And I will repeat the question for the other candidates if needed.
Yeah. I'm very committed when it comes to that. I believe we need to protect our green spaces. And part of that, we need to look at the zoning here in around this area especially. And so we need to, when we start building, and when we get rid of green space, there's no way how you can get it back. And so we need to make sure we need to focus on preserving that, especially around the missions. And it's very important that we get the community involved. And so that's what I'm trying to push, community involvement and being one-on-ones with the community and seeing how we can go about to protecting our environment and protecting our green spaces.
Thank you. Hello?
Thank you. Okay. I'm very proud of the work that I've participated in as an activist, as a local grassroots organizer, to make sure that the city follows through on their promises to prioritize green spaces, care for our water, and beyond that, right? As a cultural organizer, it's important for us to continue talking about the sacredness of water, the sacredness of these. They're more than resources. They're not just resources. They are part of our lives. They are part of the cycle of our lives and of our connection to each other. And it's important that we continue to prioritize those things at City Hall. What happened with Vista Ridge was, unfortunately, I think really largely due to City Hall not respecting the perspective of the community. There were plenty of community scholars, community researchers that offered information that would make it very clear that Vista Ridge was not the way to go, that there other conservation efforts to fulfill, and City Hall did not respect our perspective on that. Thank you.
I'm very proud of the fact that we're also working in low impact development for the new development, and I have also carried the cause, especially in and around our creeks and our river, but throughout the city of San Antonio, to look at not just pervious cover on site on parking lots, but impervious cover to make it less flooding, but also safer. Thank you.
I am also committed to making sure about our trees. I'll give you an example. Where I live, it's a dead end street. And there's property where my son has a vacant lot, and the neighbor in front of me called Code Compliance because she wanted that tree knocked down. So, of course, I was getting ready to leave, and I went up to talk to him, and he told me, yes, can I help you? I said, well, this property belongs to my son. So I told him, is there a problem? He said that there was a complaint, which was the neighbor, that wanted to have that knocked down. And he said, this is not the way it works. If we feel that we can save it, we'll save it. So I'm for saving any tree, but if we can't, then we will replace it. Thank you.
Okay, with water, our Vista Ridge is the worst investment San Antonio has ever made, all right? I have an idea, and it's been lurking around everybody's minds in the past, you know, few years. Rainwater reservoir on the north side of San Antonio, instead of doing a pipeline and privatizing our water system so they can hike our bills every month. On our green spaces, I stand for no development. Doesn't matter what it is around the missions, Concepcion, Espada, San Jose. I do not want any development done by special interest groups around that area. We have plenty of spaces everywhere else. LNH, there's a lot of. We need a good representation to bring good development to District 3. Also, environment. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for answering that first question. Now we'll move on to our second question. And as always, if you need me to repeat the question, please ask me. I'll be more than happy to do so. So the next question, how will you work with neighborhood associations to provide win-win solutions to the imminent displacement of longtime residents that is a direct impact of gentrification?
Thank you. Unfortunately, that's exactly the lack of effort that I've witnessed, that I've experienced, which was part of my motivation to enter, you know, and participate in this election. I do think that it's a very difficult job to really engage neighbors and really create those solutions, but I absolutely know that it is possible. And that comes from the skills that I've developed as an organizer, as a community service worker, to know and respect that there is a way for us together to come to solutions. Again, first and foremost, we need to create those spaces where people will truly come together and gather and exchange information, exchange perspectives. Many of the neighbors that are in most imminent danger of being displaced have the best ideas for what might remedy that. What happened at Mission Trails, there were many people that said, I understand I need to move. I understand I don't own the lot, but there are different ways to remove us, to relocate us, and to make sure that this doesn't disrupt our legacies.
I will continue to work with the neighborhood associations and the people in the immediate neighborhoods and streets that live along the areas, going door to door, talking to them, as I did with the Mission Trail neighbors, going door to door, knocking on their door, speaking with them. I think it was a very difficult and terrible situation that the families were put into, but it was not just a zoning case. What it was is these families were put into an impossible situation by an out-of-state negligent property owner who was not taking care of the property and who had the authority to kick them out within 15 days until stepping in and making sure that we had some sort of financial assistance for those families. This is what working with them, but working with the neighborhoods and the neighbors in the streets, in the community, because we know that we need to have a balanced approach in our community. For far too long, we've been overlooked, and I want to continue to give voice to our community. Thank you.
Absolutely. How will you work with neighborhood associations to provide win-win solutions to the imminent displacement of longtime residents that is a direct impact of gentrification? And you can also ask me to rephrase the question.
Well, it seems like it always falls back to the same situation that the Mission Trail with the home park people that were, the 300 people that were displaced. I would never, never allow something like that. If I'm going to represent you, I will make sure that I'm going to say, like I said it earlier, and I'll say it again, Sylvia Dono se vende. I will make sure that all of you are safe because you put me in this position if I'm elected. It's not about Sylvia Don. It's not about how much I make. It's nothing like that. It's about you, the community, coming together. And I will do whatever it takes for me to go out and talk to all the people, whatever it takes. If it's 2 years, I'm there.
Gentrification, right? That's happened to a lot of us, not just in Mission Trails or anything like that, but $2.5 billion of our tax money put into the city. Now, we can definitely develop something to help the older generation who picks up their home and let them live in peace until they want to move or sell, all right? $2.5 billion, we can make it. We can make that into good use for our older generation. Now, also town hall meetings. I would not come around at our election day and ask for your vote. I'm going to be out there, not just once every 6 months, but every month, developing town hall meetings in all the neighborhoods in the south side of San Antonio, so that way we can get the feedback of people that live in the district, not special interest groups that want to invest in our future. Thank you.
I think working with neighborhood associations is very important, but not just neighborhood associations, going directly to the residents, because they're the ones who are struggling. They're the ones who have their comments and their concerns. In a span of 3 weeks, I've already had two town hall meetings, and we're going to have another one this coming week. And so I'm not even councilman yet, and this is very important. Why? Because we need to go directly to the residents and make sure, you know, we're hearing their problems and how are we going to find solutions to those problems. And so I'm committed to working with neighborhood associations and any neighborhood, because it's very important that we care for our communities and we care especially for our seniors.
So let's go ahead and do question number three. Explain how you will protect the missions as well as your commitment to area beautification and smart development in the World Heritage Overlay District.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm very proud to have been able to work with you all here in the Mission San Jose Neighborhood Association, but with the surrounding areas as well, and actually open it up to everyone in the city to talk about what we want to see in this area. Because as natives and as those who've been invested for years and decades into this community, it's important that our voices get heard, and it has been heard in our World Heritage Work Plan, with our authentic nature that we want to see small legacy businesses in our community, because this area is something special to the entire world, but most importantly, to the families that told the stories and continue to tell the stories over and over again. With our beautification, I'm proud to say in this bond, we have over $100 million to the District 3 area. Part of that becomes $2.25 million in there to have money for open space to protect areas around the missions. Thank you.
Well, I think that it is very important to preserve our missions. This is a story that it says about our south side, and I would definitely make sure that whatever it takes, I will do to preserve the mission. I've taken my grandchildren out there and they're so excited. And I hope that we can continue to do that, my grandchildren's children and grandchildren. And I feel that we need to, if I'm elected, that I will also, something that nobody has ever talked about is if we ever have a bond, I will do and give you a summarize of how the money is being spent for that bond. Thank you.
Again, how are we going to save the missions around in San Antonio, in our neighborhoods? Number one, green spaces. We need to make sure, and I said it earlier, I stand for no development around the missions from special interest groups. We need to preserve that area. And we need to spend our taxpayers' money into District 3, developing our homes that are been in the family for 100 years, 150 years, and let's not put a tax on people to put them on a system where they have to pay a tax because their house is 100 years old or whatever, you know? And that's what's happening now. Do you want to make your house that you've been there 100 years or 150 years, you have to pay a tax on it, so that way you can qualify. And we need to take that out. That's how we can beautify San Antonio. Okay, thank you.
Just to clarify, it was about the missions, how we're gonna preserve the missions.
Sure, I can reread the question. Explain how you will protect the missions as well as your commitment to area beautification and smart development in the World Heritage Overlay District.
So, I'm in support of development, but development that honors and respects the residents living there, especially around the missions. And the missions, obviously, is something special. And for the South Side, we're proud of that. And it's great to have a World Heritage site, you know, where we live. But at the same time, we need to remember the indigenous people. We need to remember the families. And the culture, we need to preserve the culture that's around the missions, and we need to look for, you know, ways to look and care for the residents living around the missions. Now, development is great, but we need to make sure that those residents are being taken care of, these residents. And so I'm for preserving and taking care of the missions, because that's something we are proud of. And so that's what I'm backing.
Our history, our stories are so important because they ground us. We need to also be sure that we learn from this history, from these stories. We must acknowledge the cycle of displacement that has happened throughout the missions and that unfortunately continues to happen. We have to learn from this story, from this history, and make sure that the people of the Southeast Side, of the South Side, of these neighborhoods surrounding the missions do not fall through the cracks of the development and the historic designation that is occurring. As exciting as it is, as necessary as it is, we need to make sure that the whole story is told and that due respect is given to the living history of the neighborhoods that surround the missions. That is smart development. Smart development is respectful development of the neighbors that have been here, the neighbors that want to continue to be here, and that are themselves part of this living story, this living history. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for being so kind and cooperating with that rascally microphone. So I appreciate it. Thank you. So, question number 4. Please explain your commitment to supporting affordable housing and safety in our community. For example, single-family homes, senior housing, and crime watch programs. So.
Well, I feel that all of those that you mentioned are very, very important, and this is what I propose to do if I am elected. It definitely is important for safety. I hear so many people that they're afraid to go out. Well, I will do the best to my ability to make sure that we have enough lighting, that our seniors will be able to go out and not be afraid, as unfortunately crime is very high right now. And we need more police officers, if it fits the budget, and we'll make sure, because this is our community and we need to make sure that everybody is safe where we live. The affordable housing, of course it is. We need it. There's a lot of people that don't make that much money. That's why I'm also for $15 an hour. Thank you.
Okay. We do need affordable homes in District 3. We don't have any. Everybody keeps moving to the north side. Our children go over there. We need more affordable housing in District 3. We do not need any more subsidized apartments in District 3. We don't need any more trailer parks. We don't need any more apartments that our constituents can't afford to live in. We need affordable homes. Our safety also, more speed bumps into the neighborhoods, more policemen patrolling our District 3. We need more people creating crime watch programs in our communities, and I will help you do that. And we are best watchdogs in our communities, and we keep ourselves together and report anything that's going on wrong. We will help each other. Okay, thank you.
Public safety is very important, especially in this side of the town. When we look at public safety, we look at crime, and how are we going to protect our seniors? Now, forming neighborhood watch programs, going to town halls, making town halls, going to neighborhood association meetings, that's the way we can come to solutions. Now, we can put as much money as we want into police, into different, you know, organizations, but in the end, it's the resident. You know, our community, our neighborhood, we look after each other. And for protecting our seniors, you know, whether it be forming an organization where we put video cameras in these seniors' homes, in senior homes, and protecting their land and their property. And so in the end, we look out for each other, and that's the way it should be. And so whether it be through Nextdoor app, different solutions, different neighborhoods have different ways of communicating. And it's important that we find out what those means of communication are.
Affordable housing and neighborhood safety, I think, are two really critical elements of una vida digna, a life with dignity. It's what we have a very basic right to, and I believe that affordable housing has everything to do with being able to afford to age in place or to age in the place where you want to age, right? There are many families, many elders that want to stay, you know, in the homes that they live in but are not able to keep up with needed repairs. We need to make sure that we strengthen neighborhood networks that do exist to assist them with those repairs so that they can age where they want to. If they, you know, pass on and leave these homes to other family members that want to continue to live in the South Side, they should be able to afford those taxes. They shouldn't have to be worried about what other development projects, what the impact of other development projects will have on their taxes. We need to make sure that people feel that people have the ability to live where they want to live. And thank you.
Absolutely. The question is, please explain your commitment to supporting affordable housing and safety in our community. For example, single family homes, senior housing, and crime watch programs.
Thank you. My commitment has been and remains strong to affordable housing in the city of San Antonio. We see the rise in our housing costs throughout the city, and we know that there's development and that there's growth coming to the city in general, but we want to be sure that where we live, that we can, one, stay here, but then if our children and grandchildren want to come back to the South Side, to the Southeast Side, that they have quality that they can come back to and that they can maintain. And they are in our neighborhoods. One of the things that I'm very proud of right now is that we do have coming forward in the bond, neighborhood improvement bond, which discusses affordable housing. And I know Mission San Jose has been there in support and advocating of it, because in this area, it's something that we want to make sure that we can have. Many of our seniors, unfortunately, if they're widowed, they have to move out. We want them to be able to stay here in the area they grew up in. Thank you.
And we move on to our final question. You know, this question is actually a two-piece question. So if you feel comfortable as the candidates to concentrate on one piece, that is perfectly fine, because it is a multifaceted question, just so everybody knows. So again, it's a rather complex question. It's got two facets to it. So if you want to just, you know, concentrate on one, you're more than welcome to. But if you want to tell us what your whole plan is, that's even better. So just leaving that up to you and what you want to concentrate on. So question number five, what is your commitment to bringing knowledge worker jobs rather than service and laborer jobs to the South Side? Along with that, how will you ensure that our neighborhood residents have the training and education to fill high-paying, highly skilled, knowledge-based careers?
Okay, first of all, we need to get rid of Scully. All right, we need to get rid of her, so that way they can, when we go into a city council with new blood in there, we can develop our own strategies to come into District 3. That's how we can do that. We need to fight every council person for District 3 wanted to think they're going to fight to bring jobs. We need a strong councilman that will fight to bring in new jobs into District 3. That's how we need to do that. We need to go after developers and to bring them over to District 3. We got so much vacant land out here that is so less cheaper than the north side. All right, and then training. All right, training, we need to let people that don't want to go to college, we can develop some training schools in South Side of San Antonio where we can develop welders, mechanics, and so forth and so forth. And I will do that. I will bring those kind of schools to the South Side. Thank you.
I think education is very important, and it starts in the high schools, starts in the middle schools. I want to implement trade schools into the high schools. You know, they are our future mechanics, they are our future plumbers. And you know, college isn't for everybody. And so we need to focus on how will we promote a small business, and how will we promote and push them to excel in their future. They are our future. And so I want to push to promote small business, and not only promoting them, but educating them, and how to start up, you know, these entrepreneurs. And so that is one of my main focuses is small business. And so as well as educating our high schoolers and our incoming entrepreneurs.
I'm very excited about the newly developed extensions of various universities that are coming into the South Side. I think that proximity, just, you know, physical proximity to educational institutions is really important, and that's a great first step for us to take towards making education more accessible. I really hope and envision that these stations of education become also larger community institutions. We need to really broaden what our idea of education is and acknowledge the respect that we should have for, you know, the conocimiento that we have as gente, as workers, as belonging to various trades that have literally built this city, right? And especially the South Side. I think it's important, and I think that one way we do that is also by creating more innovative ways and more continuous ways to connect community resources, community service providers with schools, so that education is improved along the way before we even reach those institutions. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe all jobs, all types of jobs are important to a thriving community and to a thriving society. I do believe that our education is key. And I'm proud here in the Southern Sector and in District 3, we have examples of that with our Harlandale STEM Early College High School, with robotics teams that are already in the elementary schools, with our own corporate companies that are here in District 3 investing in that future with Alamo Academies and with the different schools like Toyota investing in the other, in our elementary schools, in our middle schools, and in our high schools. I'm proud that we're going to continue to build on that with internships, what we see at Holt Cat, that we see happening at Stinson Airport, in aeronautics and aviation. We continue to build on that. And with the new medical school at UIW, the internships, how they're going to go out into the community, out into the ISDs, and work with the families. Thank you.
Well, finally got it right. Okay, well, I feel that it is very important. Education is very important, of course, and bringing more programs to the South Side is so important. When my daughter was going to school to McCollum, a situation happened with her. She was working in the evenings, and she became, unfortunately, a victim of a drive-by shooting back in 1991. And unfortunately, the people that were there at school, the superintendent included, did not care to help her get her education. So I am for education, for bringing up more to our South Side. I am a sibling, we're six. Time is up.
You can wrap it up.
Okay, and I stayed in the South Side. It's very important. My sisters went to the North Side. Hey, I was raised here, and I'm gonna stay, and I'm gonna do whatever it takes to bring whatever we need to better, not only North Side, but we deserve in the South Side. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all of the candidates. Now, at this point, we're going to open it up to directed questions to any one of them. So they're not going to be able to, not enough time. They'll have some time to respond to any directed questions. And just to remind you, Nathan Carrizales, Jessica O. Guerrero, Rebecca J. Viagran, Sylvia E. Don, and Ismael Reyes. So if you have any questions, please direct it to one of them, and I will hand them the microphone. Does anyone have any questions?
So you're asking that you mentioned to have to direct questions.
Can't get
questions to all of them. I have a question for all of them.
I think we have time.
Okay.
I think we have time.
Great. So hi. For our district. But one of the things, everyone has a mission, everyone has a vision and ideas. We all understand that there's policies and procedures that you have to work with and go through, and it's just not on your own, you have to go through a team. So my question is, how are you going to implement your mission and your ideas for our district while working with 10 other district and mayor and Cheryl Smiley?
Who wants to take it first?
So I think it's very important, it's very important that we, for example, these town halls that I'm having, this is where I sit down and I speak with the residents and see what exactly is the issue in your neighborhood. I can sit here and say, oh, this neighborhood has this problem, this neighborhood has this problem, but how am I supposed to know if I don't go and speak with them? Now, yes, there are, hoops and hurdles to get the things done, but my main focus is, seeing what needs to be done and how can I work with, the other council members to bring light, hey, District 3, my neighborhood needs this. If you're not going to help me, then I'm going to find ways to get, make sure that gets done. And so it's transparency. It's communication with the constituents, and that's very important. That's what I really want to push, communication.
Thank you. We're giving them about a minute.
Thank you for asking that. I think that's a really important question. And I think that that's something I've been thinking about a lot, especially through block walking, because really the difference in the districts are just a line on a map. It's not really something that we perceive as part of this community, right? We have, you know, business, family, fun, in any other area throughout the city. And I think especially what is lacking very much lately in City Hall is a lack of collaboration and solidarity between the inner city districts, 1 through 6, 7, right? I think it's really important that the representatives of each of those districts really, you know, approach things as a collaboration to bring our districts, you know, back into the running, right? To catch up with all of those years of neglect that all of us have experienced. I have no fear to stand alone on certain issues if it's a matter of principle, but I do acknowledge that it's absolutely necessary to collaborate and find common ground with my council colleagues to make sure that we move forward together.
Thank you for the question. It is, it's about building relationships, it's about collaboration, and it's about building a cooperation with one another. Yes, there are moments where I have to make the case for why District 3 needs certain things. I need to make the case and be able to work within the budget that we have, understanding the budget and fighting for the money for our part of town, for District 3, and identifying and bringing to light to my council colleagues and the mayor why it is that we need this stuff, why it is that we need the infrastructure, the development, the highlighting. And I have been able to do this, in particularly with SA Tomorrow Plan. Brooks area was not part of phase one. There was nowhere from the south side part of phase one implementation until I stood up and I said that we needed to include that. If you want to stop economic segregation in the city, then you need to make sure that the south side in District 3 is part of our future and part of the development in phase one. Thank you.
Well, I feel that, first of all, we need to get Cheryl Scully out because she is the one that's stopping everything and making a lot of money. Our taxpayers' dollars, who is she? Is she better than us? You gotta remember that. She's not better than us. Only our creator is better than none of us. I feel that would be the only way for things to happen here is by working together, not being a puppet and listening to Cheryl Scully. I am not a puppet. I used to be in a union representative where I used to work at Frederick's Air Conditioning, and I was the only woman in the negotiating table my last year that I was there. And I don't care what they said, they were the majority men, and I got it my way. Thank you.
Remember, District 3 has clout now. With our World Heritage, our special interest groups are going to want to come over here. We, or a councilman that's a good negotiator, will help do that. The way you do that is when you go to the table that you want to bring something over here, we can always, always talk to them. Well, do you want to bring in your special interest groups in District 3? We can fight for your special interest groups away from the missions, but yet at the same time we can bring negotiations to the table as a District 3 representative. In the 80s, I worked for RJ Reynolds Nabisco. I negotiated bringing the Winston drag race to San Antonio. I was on the other side of the fence, and I got the best of the city. but that was because they paid me high dollars to bring those kind of races to the cities. And that's the way you negotiate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we've got one more question. Do you want to ask? You want the microphone?
My name is Isabel Garza, and my husband and I are very interested in encouraging students in the South Side to get a proper education. So my question for you is, if you're going to be our representatives, I would like to know your educational background and your qualifications.
Who would like to begin? Ismael?
Thank you. That's a good question. And it's important in District 3 that we bring good education to our children. The qualifications that I have a degree in business management by UTSA. I work for three major corporations, General Electric, Coca-Cola, and R.J. Reynolds Nabisco. I put three children through college. Two went to Stanford, one went to SMU, and they all pursued their master's, and all because of the hard work of the mother and father. And, of course, we had a little bit of help from God to do that. And so that's, I know I have the experience in bringing people together as a parent, putting our three children through rough, you know, Stanford, you know, SMU, University of Michigan, NYU, you know, and we made it. So that's the experience I bring. I know how to do that. If I can do that with my children, I can do it with the community. Thank you.
Well, I'm very much for education. Like I said earlier about my daughter, she was able to, I told her that because of the discrimination, that I said, go ahead and take your GED, but that didn't stop her. Because right now my daughter, even though it took her 2 years to get better and get back to school, she has a bachelor's degree. Nobody should be able to stop you from getting an education, and I'm for it. I'm one of the parents that I am for education. I have a high school education, and that's why I promoted my daughter that nobody has a right to stop you to get any kind of education, especially it wasn't her fault for what happened to her. And I'm all for it. Education is so important, and I will do whatever it takes. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm very proud that with the sacrifice and work of my family, I have received my Bachelor's of Science in Geography and Urban Planning from Texas State University in San Marcos. In all fairness, it was Southwest Texas at the time. My minor was in geology. I worked my entire time as I was up working and going to school. I've had the honor of earning my Master's of Public Administration from St. Mary's University here, and worked the entire time full-time as well. And I committed to leadership development and growing our students with my District 3 Legacy Leadership Initiative. That's an investment of raising leaders, grassroots leaders in District 3 to continue to grow and continue to pursue their education. As a daughter, as a granddaughter of someone who my grandparents only completed the 6th and the 8th grade, and my parents weren't able to go to high school, I'm proud to continue the legacy and continue the legacy of education. Thank you.
Jessica.
Thank you. I grew up here on the Southeast Side. Again, I went to St. Margaret Mary's Catholic School for 1st through 8th grade. And that was a certain grounding and a certain beginning there. I went on to Highlands High School, so I did gain that experience in private and public school, which I really appreciated. I attended a couple years at Incarnate Word. It was still called the college then, and a couple years at SAC. I have not completed a degree. It wasn't the discipline of education that was for me. I've chosen a life of service to my community and gained experience and knowledge through oral history, through just exchange with communities. I've been really blessed to be able to surround myself with really incredible mentors that have really beautiful hearts, really beautiful minds that share their experience, their education, from, you know, institutions to streets and everywhere in between. So I do consider myself a very, a person with a lot of conocimiento that's gained it, you know, in a certain way, and I encourage everyone to pursue the education that's right for them.
I believe education is very important, and I've been fortunate enough to speak at high schools already, pushing these juniors and seniors to apply for colleges, to apply for scholarships. And currently, I attend the University of the Incarnate Word, and I'm happy to say, I'm proud to say that I graduate a week after the election, so I'll be getting my degree in communications, Bachelor of Arts in Communications. And you know, that goes back, the key is communication. And that's what we need in District 3. That's what we need in our neighborhoods. And so I want to bring that to the table. I want to bring my skills and my passion for public service. And so, yes, education is very important. And I'm proud to say, you know, I'm about to graduate Southsider. And part of that's come, you know, I've met great people over there. And when they ask me where I'm from, they say the Southside. I say the Southside, and they give me that certain look. And, you know, that just the lack of respect. And so we need to get more high schoolers to apply for colleges and to apply for scholarships, and so that's very important.
Thank you, Terry. Would you like to take one more question? One more or a few more? Just one more, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Can we reach?
You can step up. I'm so sorry.
No problem.
Go ahead.
Well, it's not so much a question. But I want to give a testimony about my life and my child's life. I had one daughter. She grew up with the Harlandale district, too. And she did stray and got the GED afterwards. But now she's in college at Palo Alto. 2 years, she's going to be a deputy. And for myself, well, I finished Bible school and I finished Bible college. I'm a graduate from GED from Harlandale, too, because I couldn't get there. But I like the fact that y'all had all these backgrounds of all y'all's education, because then, you know, my daughter, I had to be single parent. And I like the fact that you don't just, it's not what the teachers tell you, what the principals tell you, yeah, that's good. But to have our district people be part of that education means that you can soar and you can go as high as God wants you to go. I mean, just keep on going and going. And my question would be, I personally gather information from this community. I let people know, and I would like to tell people. What kind of things would y'all be bringing into this community besides the fact that that's going to be a YMCA right there? Is there anything coming up in the future so I can spread it around? Because I live right there in La Posada, thanks. And I go to the church there on mission. The question is, did y'all have any future plans for the district?
So, just to rephrase it, if you have any future plans, or what would be your future plans, what do you know of, or what would be some things that you would want to bring into District 3? Okay, who wants to take it? Okay, we'll let Don.
Well, to me, what's more importantly is you, the community. And I would have meetings in different areas of District 3 so I could get your input, because it's what y'all want, what you need in the south side, southeast side of District 3. I would make sure that I would get all that input and start from there. That's why I am here, for you. The community, this is very important. What you want is what I'll go out and get for you. What do we need also, of course, and this is what I propose to do, is try to get your input. I'm sure someone wanted this. You got it. I will do the same. Thank you.
Um,
Well, we'll continue to work together to bring the enhancements that we are looking for in the district. The bond has many opportunities here with the upcoming bond election. We have the enhancements around Roosevelt Park and South Presa and Mission Road. We're looking at more and non-confusing signage up and down our corridor over here. We're looking for enhanced park space here in and around the area and in all of the parks in District 3. You know that we just had our senior center at Southside Lions Park yesterday that has low impact development and that is there and it's high quality, so because we are worth it and we deserve it here in the southern sector of San Antonio. One of the things that we're working on with the neighborhood for our World Heritage Work Plan is what kind of local small businesses do we want to see in the area? Is it, it's gonna be authentic, but is it restaurants? Because we wanna make sure if people are coming, that they stay here and they visit with our local community. Thank you.
Thank you again for that really important question and for sharing your story. One of the things that I would like to do is to do monthly block walks and not wait for people to come to a cafe with the council person, but to actually go out into the neighborhood, hand deliver newsletters that include various updates and really continue to build an understanding of what neighborhood networks need to be better supported, right? I would like my field office to double as a resource center to offer printing so that if people are planning fundraisers, planning info sessions, they have that ability to not only print, make copies of flyers and distribute them, but also, you know, help in distributing those flyers, help in creating those flyers, learning a new skill, doing some graphic design, whatever, you know, maybe some drawings, connecting with high schools and young artists to create those visual welcome signs, you know, that we need to engage people more in community work. And my time is up, but I do have more plans.
So through town halls, through community engagement, we can see what the constituents, what the residents want. You know, I can sit here and say, I want this, I want that, but in the end, it's what the community wants. And so, you know, why not have a senior center down here? And you know, different plans and different development. Now, one of the things is to make sure that the communication is there with the constituents. And so it's very important that's what I want to bring to the table. And so just open communication, one-on-ones with the community, and looking to move forward. And so the development is up to the residents and constituents of District 3 and the different neighborhoods.
My vision for District 3 is around the missions. I want to have more community centers that are to be used by our constituents, community centers that we can have festivals, where we can have meetings, we can have get-togethers, we can have whatever we need to do for our constituents, maybe develop some souvenir shops inside the community centers. And that proceeds, instead of going to the city, going to a homeowners association. That can be done if city council votes for that, especially if I go into it. Another thing that I can bring to the community is that we need to have outreach programs from universities around the nation to bring staffers to recruit kids, children from our district to go to these Ivy League schools or to the higher education schools that are renowned in throughout the United States. And we can develop that. We can hold town hall meetings and bring our staffers from the universities and come talk to our children. That's what I would bring to District 3. That's my vision. Thank you.
Well, Terry has said we have time for one more question. Yes, sir. If you want to just project, if not, I'll repeat it.
Hey, I appreciate y'all's time coming out here, standing up to the drilling and everything like that. So it's a pleasure to get out here and have an opportunity to interact with y'all. Undoubtedly, in District 3, there's probably a whole lot of opportunity that we can take advantage of. But even the best initiatives fail without focus. So just understanding from a candidate's perspective, what is your primary focus? I mean, what are you investing the majority of your time addressing for this district?
would like to take that first?
Thank you. Again, one thing that I feel very strongly about and that has come up today a lot is really building community engagement, building that hope, resurging that hope that people I think have lost, that their voice might be heard at City Hall, that their perspective might be taken into consideration when big decisions come up. That is a huge focus for me. I think that's really important and critical to the success of any community. Another thing that I would like to really focus on is following through on some of the pending projects that have been initiated. Again, what happened at Mission Trails was so terrible, and it didn't end there, right? The impact of that displacement on families endures and is lasting. And aside from that human impact, there sits a 22-acre gigantic empty lot 3 years later. You know, where's the follow through? The development that was promised at Pecan Valley with the golf course, it's a snake pit sitting there. We need to follow through on these projects. And that doesn't justify some of the means, but at least we can move to another place.
Beautiful.
It was a tough call. Who am I going to give it to first?
Okay, well, what was the question again? What was the question?
What is your primary focus for the district?
Oh, okay. My primary focus on the district is jobs. We need good paying jobs in District 3. We need to fight for our jobs to bring them over here to District 3. We need Exxon, whoever, IBM, we need that not to depend on Scully and all those other people that bring in jobs to the other side of the city. We need to bring jobs, good paying jobs, and that's what I'm going to be focusing on. I need to also improve education at our local school districts. We need to have 100% participation to develop our public schools in District 3, Harlandale, McCollum, everybody. I want to have, okay, my time is up. Thank you.
I know you were jumping up, and then ladies want to go Sylvia, and then I'm going to go.
So everything is important, all issues. And so, when we talk about health and wellness, just yesterday I had an event at Pickwell Park. I invited the community to come out and play a pickup game with me, promoting health and wellness, promoting, all those kids to come out and, be active. At small business, I'm in support of small business and entrepreneurs. I envision, culinary boutiques that reflect the culture of District 3 up, especially the missions. Imagine going in somewhere and you learn how to make tortillas or gorditas. And so it's something different that I want to push. When we go into infrastructure, when we go into public safety, my grandmother was just diagnosed with dementia, and that is one of my main focuses, protecting our seniors, making sure that they're safe. And not just the seniors, the entire neighborhoods. And so how can we push to promote public safety? And so those are some of the many issues that I'm really trying to touch on.
One thing that I would focus on is getting, I lost my train of thought here. Can you repeat it again?
Yes, ma'am. So what are you specifically looking to address or focus on for the district?
Oh, okay, thank you. I know that here in the South Side, as I was a single parent, I got married very young, and I chose to get married and not get an education as far as going to college. So what I would want to do, because I had to work two jobs because I became a single parent, and I would try to do something for that situation like that, which nowadays, unfortunate, there's a lot of kids that are getting married very young, not finishing school. I would want to get a program to help them. It's just like when you go and you see the Army, Navy, Marines. Well, I would like a program like that for the community. My time is up. Thank you.
My focus will be to continue to maintain the dignity and respect that we deserve here in District 3, to continue to be a voice and not just a seated, not just be seated at the table, but to maintain our voice and that it would be heard. We have our infrastructure that is still in much need right now to maintain the attention and the importance on that infrastructure development, because we have streets that have not been fixed for years, for decades, and to maintain that we have those streets, because when we get our streets fixed, then we have our sidewalks put in, and then we have those investments from the private investors, from the small businesses there, that they don't have to worry about maintaining the streets in front of their houses. They can focus on doing their job and doing their business. So making sure that is still at the forefront of my focus of this term and throughout the term. Thank you very much.
Everyone, thank you very much. And that was our last question that we were taking, but let's go ahead and thank all of our candidates that were here with us today and for taking the questions and showing the interest. And thank you very much for being flexible with the format. We kind of changed things up a little bit. But as of course, as always, fairness is always one of our major concerns. Thank you so very much also for cooperating with the Rascally Microphone. Thank you. Appreciate it very much. And folks, I'm not sure about their schedules, but by all means, for those of the candidates who can, stay for a little bit. There's some cafecito, hay donitas, ¿qué más quieres? And if you would like to approach any of the candidates and ask some more questions, maybe something you wanted clarification or didn't get a chance to do, please do so. Thank you very much. Gracias por venir.